Before defining the notion of a pedagogic task in more theoretical terms, let me give you an example of a pedagogic task. I live in a small town north of London, so I take the train to London to get to the university. I arrive at a train station called St. Pancras International. There are usually a lot of tourists at the station, and they often approach me with questions like how to get to the British Museum or the British Library, which are both close to the station, and actually the UCL IOE, where Amos, Mia, and I work. An example for a pedagogic task would be if a second language learner were asked to give directions from St. Pancras International train station to the British Museum. Why would this activity constitute a pedagogic task? Peter Skian's general off-cited definition of a task describes pedagogic tasks in terms of four criteria. First, pedagogic tasks are activities where meaning is primary. In other words, tasks are different from traditional language learning activities, which often involve decontextualized language use and are exclusively focused on a particular aspect of language, for example, grammar or vocabulary. Clearly, in the MAP task, the language learner's primary focus is on conveying meaning, as they need to explain the directions to the tourist. The second characteristic of tasks that Skian mentions is that there is some communicative problem to solve. In the literature, this is also referred to as having a gap, for example, an information gap or an opinion gap between the communication partners. In the case of the MAP task, there is a clear information gap. One of the language users knows the directions towards the British Museum, whereas the other does not. The third task criterion says that there is some sort of relationship with real-world activities. In other words, tasks are similar to or simulate activities that people do in real-life settings. Again, returning to the example of the MAP task, although people increasingly rely on their phones for directions, people like me still stop others in the street for help if they get lost. Finally, a fourth defining characteristic of a task has to do with how it's assessed. Tasks are assessed in terms of the non-linguistic outcome of the task. So we are not only interested in the quality of language used during task performance, but also whether the actual communicative purpose of the task has been met. To continue with the example of the MAP task, it's possible to give directions that are perfectly accurate in terms of language use, but send the listener to a wrong part of the town. In this situation, the communicative outcome of the task would not be met. Other examples of pedagogic tasks include calling an ambulance, ordering in a restaurant, describing an illness to a doctor, telling a story based on pictures, listening to an academic lecture, writing a cover letter for a job application, or reading an email that requires a follow-up action. Note that this list indicates that tasks may involve the use of any of the four skills: speaking, listening, writing, and reading. It's a misconception that tasks only refer to oral activities or activities that rely on the skill of speaking. Now let's consider two activities that would not meet the criteria for tasks. These are inspired by two examples from Rod Ellis's seminal book on task-based language teaching. You can often find this type of cute role-play activity in language teaching textbooks. You might want to pause the recording for a moment to have a quick look. Although this activity elicits language use that may occur in real life, it could not be categorized as a task because all that learners need to do here is to find suitable language to convey the meaning, which is already given as part of the task input. Also, the activity doesn't lead to a non-linguistic outcome. The only outcome is the language that's produced during task performance. Of course, this is not to say that such cute role-play activities are not useful for language practice. They just don't constitute examples of tasks. Now have a quick look at this activity. Again, you might want to pause the recording for a bit. This activity does not seem to meet any of the task criteria we highlighted. The focus is clearly on grammar rather than meaning. The aim of the activity is to practice the use of there is and there are. There is no communicative problem to solve. The students have exactly the same information available, so there is no information or opinion gap involved. Also, the language is unlikely to be used in dialogues like this in real life. Finally, the task has no outcome other than the language produced.